Emily Pursley here with Channel 18 Valley TV, and today we're here at the Sequatchie County Veterans Memorial Park to discuss with you about the history of Veterans Day. The United States annually observes Veterans Day on November the 11th. It honors the military veterans who have served the United States Armed Forces. It coincides with other holidays such as Armistice Day and Remembrance Day that are celebrated in other countries to mark the anniversary of World War I. When World War I was formally ended at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month in 1918, when the armistice with Germany went into effect. The following year, President Woodrow Wilson declared that November the 11th would be known as Armistice Day. Armistice Day was primarily set aside to honor the World War I veterans, but in 1954, after World War II, November the 11th became known as a day to honor all American veterans who had fought in all wars, now known as Veterans Day. We are so happy to present to you today our Veterans Day special, including interviews with your local veterans here in the Sequatchie Valley. Thunder in the Valley, Civil War in Sequatchie County. The outbreak of the war divided Sequatchie County families, and local men served on both sides of the conflict. Union and Confederate armies marched through the county, civilian law broke down, and marauders used the conflict as an excuse to rob, kill, and settle old scores. The William Rankin House, the first dwelling built in Dunlap, was pillaged and Rankin fled. Thousands of soldiers marched on the county's roads and turnpikes. In August 1862, Confederate General Braxton Bragg's army passed through on its way north to invade Kentucky. Late in the summer and fall of 1863, after the Battle of Chickamauga, the country served as a base for both Union and Confederate armies at different times during the battles for Chattanooga. Union Colonel John T. Wilder reported that his arrival here in August 1863 provided timely for surprising and capturing a party of 14 rebels and releasing 5 Union prisoners they were about to hang. The fight for Chattanooga directly touched the southern part of the county on October 2, 1863, when Confederate General Joseph Wheeler's cavalry attacked a Union wagon train headed for Chattanooga on the treacherous Campbell and Anderson Turnpike. The train had more than 1,000 wagons full of supplies, pulled by an estimated 4,500 mules. Wheeler's successful raid destroyed a vast quantity of Union property. Federal forces occupied Sequatchie County for the remainder of the war, but marauders still roamed the mountains and valley, harassing and stealing from the residents. The war and its aftermath created enduring resentments and wrought profound changes on Sequatchie County as on the nation. Now I'm here with Colonel Seals. How are you doing today?
Fine.
And we're going to talk about his time in the Marine Corps. So let's start with how you joined. What led up to you joining the Marines?
We were raised there in Bledsoe County. You want me to tell you about going to school?
Yeah. Sure.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, we were in a rough damn country. You had to ride a horse or wagon one to get out. And I went down to Meldon and got a place to stay all night with the tailors. And I stayed with them, went to school. I helped them feed the damn cattle, horses, and ewes, and everything else twice a day, and paid for my board that way. And I graduated from there. Well, I went to Tech first. No, I didn't. I went to Spencer. They had a college over there, and I went over there one semester. Then I went to Cookeville. Then I went to Murfreesboro. I was a hopper, I guess you called it. But anyway, after that, there wasn't any work for anybody to do then. And so I joined the Marine Corps. I was in Nashville, went to Paris Island, and I've started from there. Well, let's see, I don't remember. We had an old dirt road and tracks for wagons to get through and everything else, and that's the only road we had for a car. And it was seldom you ever seen a car when I was young. Very seldom. My father bought a truck, and my two brothers, they were about 10 years older than me. And I was 8 years old, and he was mowing the field with the horses. He broke something. He came to the house, and he said, well, he had to go get a part for it. So he looked around, and ours loaded, they were gone somewhere. And he said, can you drive that thing? I said, oh, well, I guess I could. And I was 8 years old, got in that truck, and my two sisters, they had to go along too, Minnie and Belma. And we went, he decided he better go to Crossville and get it because there wasn't any mountains to go up and down. Pikeville, we had to go down the mountains up there. And we pulled out, and I drove to Crossville, and Hale store, why, it had a parking lot. There wasn't anybody in it but me. I just pulled around in it, and he went and got his parts, and we started on back home. And I was only 8 years old, never drove a car. I sat under a shade tree at home and practiced all that time how to reach. And I couldn't reach the clutch on it. And I sat in Papa John's lap and drove that truck to Crossroads by. 8 years old. Well, I didn't have anything to do with work except work at a sawmill, and that was hard work back then for a kid. So I decided I'd join the Marine Corps. So we went down to Chattanooga, then we went from Chattanooga to Nashville to be sworn in. Then we went from Nashville, put us on a bus, and took us to Paris Island, South Carolina. We got checked in there, and in a few weeks they were needing communication people, and they didn't have any. So they thought, well, I'd make them a good one. So I went to Virginia for 6 weeks to train in communication. So we went back from Marines down to Paris Island, got on a ship, George Fox Elliott's ship, and we went from there to Panama.
Mm-hmm.
We stayed in Panama about, about 4 weeks. And then they got back on the ship and went to San Diego, California. They were resupplied. They went out in the south in the Pacific, went to Pearl Harbor. We got in Pearl Harbor is about a week before they bombed Pearl.
Was you there when the bombing happened?
Oh yes. I was on the dock about 200 feet from the ship when it was hit. And that was a scary damn time. We have this picture here that was made December the 6th, and my friend met his friend from Michigan, and we decided he wanted us to go out to Pennsylvania, and we told him we was going to go to Honolulu, so we went to Honolulu to a bar and had a picture made as a cameraman. I paid 25 cents to get that made. And how I've carried out these years, I don't know. Because I had it somewhere.
So, you went through Pearl Harbor and then?
Well, that's a long story. Well, we went to Pearl Harbor. Well, after the war in Pearl Harbor, well, to back up a little bit, we decided we wouldn't go out to Pennsylvania that night. We just go back to the tent and stay and go back and eat breakfast with them. So we got up early and going back to the ship. We were at about 250 feet of it. And we looked up and here comes a damn plane down. And it dropped a bomb on the Pennsylvania. Then we looked around. There was no place to go, but there's a hole in the ground where the water come out. So we got down and crawled in it. And Then Quezon and the Downs were right, pulled in right beside of us. Then the next wave come over, they hit both of those ships and just knocked them out of the water. And so all hell started then, I guess. And my first 2 days of working was he gave me a bucket, a gallon bucket, and I went through and picked up dog tags off of the people that killed, a bunch of them. I worked 2 days at that. I got, if they had a dog tag on them, I got one of the dog tags off and put it in the bucket, and the other one I put it in their mouth between their teeth, shut their mouth back down. Of course, they were dead. I worked at that for 2 days. Then I went back on the ship and we loaded it up with food and went from there. We started to Guam. Well, just the night before the Japanese hit Guam, they turned us around and took us back to Midway. And we stayed at Midway after the battle. When that was over, we went back to Pearl, got refilled again, and we went down the South Pacific, islands that I'd never heard of, haven't heard of them since. One was the New Hebrides group down there, and we stayed there about 2 months. Then the Marines landed at Guadalcanal, and they had more trouble up there than they thought, so they took us up to to Guadalcanal. I was a PFC, and I went from PFC to Guadalcanal to captain in 4 weeks.
Wow.
I drew one day second lieutenant's pay. And I went on through all of the battles, I guess, in the South Pacific. There's a lot of them you never heard of. And everybody in our squadron got to malaria. And there's 95% of our troops in our battalion had to damn malaria at the same time. And they didn't have any atabrine. That's one thing that saved us. And a plane come from Australia up there and landed on the beach, and he had a load of atabrine. They started giving that to everybody, and it got well. And from that, we went on. Oh, yeah, they sent me home to the States for rest and relaxation. And after I got out of the damn tent where I could go, and I was supposed to stay a month, so I got back to the States, and I stayed 2 weeks, then went back to Honolulu. Then I went back to San Diego. Went back and to San Diego, and then I went from there to San Francisco, and I got on a flying boat and flew back to Pearl Harbor. Wow. And that's back up when, in the Battle of Midway, I was in a control tower.
Mm-hmm.
And the Japanese would fly up, come up at night and fire at everything, try to get us to open up before we were dug in. And they had two men in that tower, and one of them didn't show up, I guess for some reason. So they sent me up there to operate that tower, watch where the Japanese are firing from. And everything was quiet. And my buddy was down in the basement of it. It's what you call the command post. All the wheels are down there. And everything is quiet. And I said, Morris. He said, yeah. And I said, what's the color of blood? He said, well, I guess it's red. Well, that's better then, because I think if it's yellow, I'm shot all hell. And commander said, who was that? And my commander was down there, and he said, well, that's just one of my boys. And about 15 minutes, that damn tower got hit. And I guess they're about two-thirds up. They just knocked it over, and it was just hanging there. And my buddy and I was in it. We stayed there about 30 minutes before somebody come and got us out. And that was a scary damn time, standing on your head for 30 minutes and firing around you everywhere else. So we got out of that one.
So, and while you were serving, how many or what kind of different, like, friendships and stuff did you make bonds with other soldiers?
Oh, you lived with them and everything else, worked with them. Everything's pretty close.
Did you keep in contact with any of them after discharge?
No. All except that one that we visited when I retired. He's the only one.
All right, do you want to tell us how you moved up to Colonel?
Well, just to be in the right place, I guess. When it back up when I was commissioned, I got on Guadalcanal, and they signed me in and said, told his sergeant to take me out to where he his the people were. And I said to him, I said, what the hell are they doing to me out here? He said, well, I'll tell you like it is. He says, I've had six commanders that all been killed. And he said, if you don't pay attention to me, you'll be the next. So I just went right over. We had there's a stream coming down, and Japanese is coming in, waiting until it got dark. Then it hit that stream, come across, try to get into a camp, hit main headquarters. And they had us lined up all along, and this man that was manning this machine gun, he got killed, laying there. And I was commissioned then. There wasn't nobody else to take his place, so they put me down in there with him. And when those Japanese had come in, well, we'd open up on them and kill them all. Then wait a while, here they come again. And that went on all night long. Japanese trying to get across that border. So we held them back, all right. Well, I moved on up, and I was the commander of Guam, the South Pacific Communications Office. And they had these 12 Navajos come in, brought them in there. Nobody to take them. They couldn't speak English. They said they couldn't, but they could, most of them. And they assigned them to me. So I went and took them down and got them a tent and put them in it and got them settled. And they put them to work. And what they would do, there's 12 Navajos. When they wanted them to monitor to see what the Japanese were doing, well, they could interpret it to our people. And they worked it up all the war, yeah. Another thing that happened on Guam, we had a mess hall set up in the tent, and right beside of it was a sheer cliff that went down to the island command. And we sat there, and there's about four of us eat together. We'd go up and get our food and bring it back, sit down and eat. And anybody wanted a drink or something, well, they'd go up. But when they come back, the plate was gone. And that went on for a damn week. And we finally, there were three of them. They went up and got them something to eat and some drinks and come back. And I seen that man's hand come up. He reached up over that, fell around, got the plate, took it back. And they was camping in this dugout right below where we were. And there's a big rock land there. And one time they went up and hear that hand come up. I knew his head was there somewhere, so I grabbed that rock, stepped up there and dropped it right straight down on his head. And that's the last we heard of him for that time. But anyway, we got the Marines went down there and found their hole where they go in. And they stayed in there and send messages back to the Japanese. So they put me in charge of it, going down and getting them. So we went down and crawled in that damn hole. Now they had a big place, everybody's sitting around. And so we cleaned them out. And one officer that was sitting there, he had a rifle on his desk, old rifle, and his pistol and everything else that was sitting around. And we, of course, we had to kill about six of them. But anyway, he gave up. He was educated in New York. He knew everybody. He graduated from college up there, and they sent him back to Japan. He told us, he said, well, I don't have anything in this for about himself. And we picked his gear up, and the rifle, well, I just carried it to it. Didn't nobody want it, just an old rifle. So after I retired, they had 10 of those rifles, the first ones ever made. And they found out that I had one. And they wrote letters through command trying to get me to get it to them, sell it to them and everything else. So I just kept it. I still got it. And it was one of the first rifles that was ever made in Japan.
Wow.
1600 something. And when they seen I wasn't going to donate to their museum in Japan after the war, they wanted to buy it from me. And they offered me $270,000 for it. So I didn't take it. And I've still got it. It's worth a lot of money now.
It's going to be worth
and on the handle of it, it's got the history of the people that had it. It passed down from one family to the other. It's engraved in the handle. I guess we shall forgive some.
Let's talk about the life after war. Like, what happened? How did you transition back when you came home?
Well, I was in Marine Corps then. So after the war, the Marine Corps was cut down. And I had a reserve commission with enlisted time. And they weeded all those people out that had 10 years or more. And I was one of them, we're going to get retired. So they had an article in the down paper that the Air Force is becoming a separate branch. So I investigated, and I put my application in. Then the Marines wouldn't let me out. So I wrote Knox, he was Secretary of Defense, and he told them to discharge me from Marine Corps, and I went over and got in the Air Force. And it was the first branch. I guess I'd have died a Marine, and they'd be up to get you someday. So I retired. When Eisenhower got in there, why, they cut the all the people had 10 years or more commissions in the war, they just retired. The first month, there was 4,000 officers let out of service, and I was one of them. And then they kept on, they got rid of all of them, just retired. Then they got these young heads coming in, but replaced them. Well, after I was, I spent a tour in Europe, too. After I was gotten the Air Force, well, they sent me to Allied Air Force in Central Europe. And Eisenhower was the commander. So I was his communications chief for 4 years. Then I came back to the States. I was at Pearl Harbor for a while. And then I went to Greenland. They was building a dew line from across the South Pole into Alaska. And I was a communications transportation officer for that operation. We had all kinds of help on that. And the planes, they would take them out and they'd land them in the damn snow and then they'd take off. So I recommended that they put skis on. So when the 130 came out, one of the first planes they had, they modified it and put skis on it. And we brought it up to Alaska and they tried it out. And they gave us 12 more aircraft, all of them modified. And we flew all over that damn line from Greenland across the North Pole into Alaska when we got that far with them. They'd land them on the plane and take off. I got a presidential citation for that.
Was there a big difference between being in the Marines and being in the Air Force?
Yeah. Because the Army, they didn't have much, didn't take pride in their uniform or anything else. They didn't wear anything. So I had mine all sharp kept. And we won every parade and they had in Seward Air Force Base, Smyrna. I'd stand up and watch everybody else go around every week for parade. Yes, I could tell you a lot about that operation. Oh yeah, when I went to Greenland, oh yeah, this is funny. They took me down to the mess hall, and I had dinner and everything. They said, well, there's 5 bedrooms right down through here. He said, you take any one of them you want. And one of them was right next to the furnace where they heated the place. I looked around, I said, hell, I'll be warm in here. And so I took that one, plenty covered, everything covered up, went to sleep. And next morning, somebody hollered and I threw the cover back, and I was down, covered up with snow. And it was coming in somewhere around the furnace. And the whole thing was covered up with snow. So I got me into a different room. And one time we had a whiteout, and we went from our barracks to our mess hall, which is about 500 feet. And when you had one of them whiteouts, you couldn't see nothing. And we had a rope tied from one to the other, so you want to go east, you've got to hold that rope, and best thing you held on to it. So you'd go over to east and go back. Of course, we didn't do anything then, they couldn't see you. I came back to Tennessee, where the prison is, right at the forks of Lantana Road, and the other one goes to prison. I had bought some land, or 80 acres, long before, and we moved to a little old log house there, and I had a house built there, and we lived in it. And one day, when a man drove up in his car, stopped, wondering what I was doing, I told him I just pitted around, and he dated a principal over at Mooneyhan School in Van Buren County. He wanted to know if I'd come over and help him. I said, well, yeah, well, so I went over, and I stayed there 2 years in one school. I stayed one, then they had another school at the entrance of the park. I stayed over there 1 year. Then my wife got a job in Crossville, and I went up to Crossville and see if I could get a job teaching. So they glad to get me. So I taught in four little schools. It is, the boys are all rough. And the last school I started is, was out toward Rennie. And Lieutenant Davis, he and I went out there. He got there and found out that I was a principal. I had four teachers out there. And they had run four principals off in the school just getting started. So we dug in. I stayed there 4 years and retired. So I stayed there for 4 years. Never had trouble with anybody. But those boys are all mean, and the parents would come in and raise hell with the teachers, so they'd run them off. I'll tell you one thing, too, that I had a little trick on getting those boys wound up. It's the first school I talked to. I knew that there's twins over there, and they run everything. And so they got into it with somebody else. I got them in there, set them down. And I had a phone book in there. It's about an inch and a half thick, laying on the desk. And while I was talking to them, I just reached over, got that phone book, and just tore it right in two. Made it back to a piece on each side. I never had no trouble out of them. Of anybody. Then another one was the midway, the one little boy come in and he says, I'm going to have my mama come up here and get you, run you off. I said, well, you just tell her, come on. And her next day, her little daddy brought him in. And he didn't like what I was doing, something or other. And I had a horseshoe, great big horseshoe, in my desk. So I was talking to him. And so I reached and got to the horseshoe and laid up on the desk. While I was discussing something with him, I just reached and got a hold of that horseshoe and I just bent it double. Laid it back down. They had left and I never heard nothing from them anymore. So that's the way you get their attention. See what you do on your phone book, you kind of bend it over, and there's just three or four pages that you're tearing at a time. You just kept ripping it. Just lays them down.
How many years overall did you serve?
23.
23.
Yeah.
What year did you come back?
60, wasn't it? I was retired in 1960.
Well, thank you so much for doing this with us. All right, and now we're here with Chaplain Follett, who is in the U.S. Air Force Reserve.
That's correct.
Thank you so much for coming down here and doing this.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
Now, do you want to tell us how you got into the Air Force?
Well, I guess we'd have to say the story goes back, pardon me, clear back to prior to our mission service in Africa in 1968. And 10 years in mission service in Africa. Prior to departing for overseas, I had received my draft notice as I had been teaching at a university in King, Texas, at Southwestern Adventist University. And I had been deferred through all the years that I was teaching. And as it turned out, once you break your tenure in teaching for my deferment, Uncle Sam said, "You no longer have a deferment, so I'm going to put my hands on you." And so in the process of getting a exit permit to leave the United States during the Vietnam War, I received my pre-induction notice to receive my physical and so forth. So I went through the whole process. I made an appeal to the draft board. Personally went in and before the board spoke with them, and they said, "Well, Mr. Follett, if you will step outside for a while, we will make our decision and tell you what our decision will be." Well, the setting out in the foyer waiting for a decision, not knowing whether I was going to go as a missionary or whether I was going to be inducted into the U.S. Army. And finally, I was called back in, and the chairman of the board looked at me very straightforward, and he said, "The board has made a decision." And with a diplomatic pause, waiting for that shoe to drop, you know, I had absolutely no idea which way it was going to go. He said, "We have decided to give you an exit permit," which meant then that I could come back into the United States without investigation why I had been outside the United States. Because many people at that time, even students, were fleeing to Canada to dodge the draft. Others were burning their draft card and so forth. Well, the feeling for me was mixed emotion, because I was ready to serve, irrespective as to how things would turn out, believing that God's hand was in the decisive process. And so with that, he said, "But I want to be able to say something to you." And he looked me straight in the face, and he said, "Young man," at that time I was 26 years old, so I was still feeling my oats and such, but it was a great adventure to be going off to Africa. He said, "Young man," he said, "the board had made a decision upon your appeal to allow you to go and serve God in Africa." He said, "I hope you will keep in your heart and mine, that if you ever return to the United States, that you will consider serving your country. And so I kept that in my heart and mind through all those years that we were in Africa, and when we would return to the United States on furlough.
How many years were you in Africa?
10 years. And then coming back on permanent return and to establish our focus of life here in the United States, and entered into pastoral ministry in the United States, I had that flashback of what that chairman of my draft board had said. And so it was then that I investigated the possibilities of service in one of the branches of the military. And I had a family, I had a church, and the concern was, do you make a dramatic change in where you're already going, or can there be a accommodation of service to God and service to your country? And so there was the National Guard option and the reserve option. And so as it turned out, I made the choice and was accepted into the Air Force Reserve Program for chaplaincy, and enjoyed multiple years of service, both in my community by serving through my church, and then within the Air Force Reserve family.
So let's talk about, was you moved, like where you were stationed in different places?
The Air Force never, in a reserve capacity, does not take charge and move you like in the regular component. Since I was serving within the community, I would be, any time that I would choose to move to a new community, then depending upon the distance of the move, I could be assigned and transferred to a new authority area, whether it be as, say, from Michigan to Tennessee. Obviously, there was no way that I could meet obligations in Michigan, so my responsibilities were transferred to Tennessee.
All right. What was the different? Did you have any different duties as a chaplain compared to if you were just a pastor?
Well, actually, one of the great things that I've said multiple times is that the training that I received in chaplain school at Maxwell Air Force Base in Alabama, that many of the practices, the hands-on application of how to relate to people in crisis, how to relate to people in a work environment, I was never taught that in seminary. That was something that, I got all the book learning. I could parse the Greek, and I could stumble through my Hebrew, and I could do my homiletics and all the rest of that, but there was never the real practical aspect of this is how you do it. This is how you get your hands dirty, if you please, or take your gloves off to be able to apply yourself in the real world of ministry. And the chaplaincy put the real world there to be able to face the crisis of notifying people and the death of their loved ones, going out to crash sites, being with the troops, the airmen as they are involved in the meticulous work of trying to be able to secure sight and then taking bit by bit, spending time with these personnel, these airmen and the officers as they have to remove the deceased from a crashed aircraft, and all the trauma that goes along with that, to be able to give them a sounding post. And I found that very helpful in my personal ministry, so that as there were individuals that met critical incidents in my churches, then I could use those same tools that the Air Force had given me to be able to reach to the community that I was serving in the church.
So while you were involved, do you feel like it caused you to meet a lot more people?
Oh, yeah.
That you would have never met otherwise?
Oh, yes. When a clergy person is inducted into any branch of the service, there is a basic training process too. And the learning of the history of the organizations, the customs and courtesies of wearing the uniform, etc. Basically, you are in kindergarten of the military, so that you learn to be a different person. And so with that, being taught different elements of who you are, and even bringing out some of the elements of your personal identity that maybe you even didn't know that you had. Initially, I have always been sort of an introvert of a person. Through my growing up years, and even as a teacher in a university setting, I always enjoyed communicating with the students in my class, but in the general population of the university campus, I didn't feel as much at ease as maybe others who could, you know, get in to an easy conversation with a student that wasn't even in their department. And so the Air Force taught me to be at ease with anyone, whether it is the basic airman right on up to a four-star general, that my position was a facilitator of communication even between that basic airman and that four-star general, with the idea that they're all human, all have concerns, all have heartaches, all had the issues that they had to struggle with, and that we were taught that we were the neutral pole for officers or enlisted personnel, that they could come to us and feel totally secure that whatever they communicated to us was held in the strictest of confidentiality. And so that was a great charge of accountability. It was a great charge of responsibility to make sure that I did all I could, whether it be Airman Basic on up through to a four-star general, to be able to be what they needed me to be at that specific time.
So you were like someone that they would always communicate to.
They could feel free to do so. It was not a command responsibility. They were not in any way, shape, or form commanded to have to come in and communicate with me. We were available. Chaplains are available. Chaplains hold services on base chapels. And you have the Catholic services, so you have Catholic chaplains. You have Protestant chaplains of multiple faiths, whether be Baptist, Methodist, Church of God, Seventh-day Adventist, as with myself. Irrespective, that was the Protestant slot. And then nowadays, there are even Muslim chaplains within the services, and that has been extended out even now that there are Buddhists that are part of different military branches, and this is not a branch of service that is limited just to men. We have many capable female chaplains, and they represent their church. They have to be vetted by their organization. The Air Force or the Army or the Navy requires that they be fully authorized and backed by their church or religious organization before they can be processed into whatever branch of service that they're called to.
Okay. So did you have any like specific friendships that were made?
Oh yes. I could think of Senior Master Sergeant Sobolowski, probably the man, I guess I could say, who made sense of the military structure and who was a guide to me and to be able to say, Chaplain, have you ever thought of, and in essence he was correcting maybe something that I was intending to do that he saw would create an issue or a problem. A very diplomatic and understanding individual. He was years older than myself. He was probably 15 years older, but he always treated me with the greatest respect. One of the things that the military, irrespective of its branch, is you learn to respect the uniform. And though he was an enlisted person, senior enlisted person, and I have to say this, that the Air Force, as well as any of the other branches, if it wasn't for the senior enlisted personnel. The fabric of our military would come apart. Those who wear metal on their shoulders do not have the nuts and bolts understanding and the real get down and get things done mechanics as the senior enlisted personnel. And I'll hold up to the highest of heaven how much I value the senior enlisted personnel in my time in the Air Force Reserve.
Well, is there any stories you would like to tell to our watchers about any big life lessons that you could have learned that you didn't think you would learn?
Well, yes, coming back to the idea of notification of next of kin. When you have a crash, it affects the whole community of that military family. Mm-hmm. And particularly in the flying community of the United States Air Force or any of the other flying parts of the other military services, there is a closeness there that when a plane goes down and there's a loss of life in that, everyone feels part of the pain and feels that loss. The first time I went out to a crash site, and as we call it, a ministry of presence, to be there, just to let them know that the chaplain's about. And often people will say, as we would come on to a crash site, you'd hear it passed around, the chaplain's here. And it was something that gave those who were meeting the moment of crisis the courage to not only with their training but with their intestinal fortitude to be able to go ahead and grasp that I could do this, I can carry this through.
It was like a comfort.
Yes, it gave them comfort there. And then when it came to the time of, in most cases, if I were detailed to be the one to give notification of next of kin, I would get all the information that I could. And the other officer and I would go to the home to make that notification. It was a matter that, yes, people knew once you started walking up to their door that this was not a friendly visit. And so they were emotionally on edge once you reached their door. But once we were able to enter into the door and be able to sit down with these people and describe the compassion and the unified pain that the Air Force family was sharing at that moment, that was always an extension of the, from those who served at the crash site having the traumatic effect of having to work that, to the medical personnel who had to relate to the deceased, right on through to recognize that this was a family event. Didn't lessen the pain of the family that lost their loved one, but later they could reflect and they knew that they were not alone. So the first time that I was in that environment to see the blackened carnage of the crash, the mangled metal and the smell of the jet fuel and the smell of the burnt paint from the aircraft itself and the foliage around. It was a mixed emotions of hitting your senses, your sight, your smell, and just the seeing how the family of the Air Force was coming together to be able to meet this critical need and to be able to make it as precisely a family event from the beginning to the end, to when that person was laid to rest. That as the honor guard and the chaplain stood at the cemetery to be able to say those last words, and then as a part of the family, when the flag is presented to the family of the deceased, all of that was a flow of the heartbeat of the Air Force in saying, "We hurt with you, but together we will live and carry on because we are Air Force strong."
Is sympathizing with the family.
Oh, yes.
So how many years were you in the reserve?
Well, 20 years and 3 months, 17 days.
So how was it transitioning back? Because after you got out, you went back to being a pastor.
Well, all through that time, I continued mm-hmm. to do my pastoral responsibilities. Yeah. My responsibilities would be a weekend a month and a two-week responsibility through the summer, unless I would be called upon in an emergency situation within the area that we were involved in.
Yeah.
And so there was never a real separation from the public domain. I think probably the separation experience was separating from the family of the Air Force, realizing then that I would no longer be a part of that second family. And so it was, as with anyone who has put any amount of service time in, there are all the memories that are connected with it, all the friendships that are there. I flash now remembering a young airman who, after he had been to Fort Benning, Georgia, and gotten his parachute qualification, he came in to me and he said, "Here, Chaplain, I'd like you to have my parachute insignia here." I said, "Well, thank you, Airman." And he said, "The reason why is because you encouraged me all through the preparation to go there. When I wanted to back out and started to have second thoughts, you encouraged me. I didn't have a dad at home to be able to talk it out with. And you there, you gave me the courage to go. And it's because of your encouragement that I am qualified now.
And I'm sure there are so many people that you touched.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Through the years, I don't know what the record of heaven will be, but I just pray that my interaction with people through the years will have been representative of my God, faithful to the service of my country, and that I honored the uniform of the United States Air Force.
Those are good points.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming down to do this.
My pleasure.
It's been an honor.
I hope that in consideration of all veterans, that people within our community will not forget that not all service is flash and dash, but all who put on the uniform have served.
Just like you said, everyone who was part of it was like a family.
Whether
you were fighting or if you were staying home as a chaplain, you were all involved, so you all deserve to be remembered just the same.
Thank you.
Now we're here with retired Lieutenant Colonel Charles Ekvall, and we're in his
Rotorhead Lounge.
Yeah, Rotorhead Lounge that he's built, that's got his memorabilia of his time in the service and his family's time in the service. So why don't you walk us through some of your time during the service? Because you were in the Army.
Correct.
During the Vietnam.
Right, during Vietnam and also during the Cold War.
Yeah.
How it worked. So, I graduated in 1964 from the University of Chattanooga, which is now the University of Tennessee, which I also got a degree from. Okay.
Yeah.
And so I'll call it the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga because that's what people are familiar with. And that's what my diploma is from also. Mm-hmm. I also then went into service, was commissioned. Was immediately sent to the 2nd Infantry Division in Fort Benning, Georgia. I was assigned as a platoon leader immediately, as a platoon. Not that platoon means anything to you. And I served with them until I was accepted to flight school. And I went to flight school, and I started out in Mineral Wells, Texas, as primary helicopter training. And helicopters were new back then, and back then they had what they known as the Experimental Division down at Fort Benning, Georgia, mm-hmm. which was known as the 11th Air Assault. The 11th Air Assault Division was a provisional division. When they were trying to prove the concept of helicopters, and one of those helicopters like that, as you see on the shelf right back here, and there's one up there on top if you want to photograph it, okay? That one up there on the left on a metal. This one is a better representation down here on the shelf, okay? But that one there. Then...
So when you were starting out, helicopters were still experimental?
Well, they were not necessarily experimental, but they had never been the doctrine for their use had never been been employed as a combat vehicle. Mm-hmm. And so what they did is they experimented in this provisional division at Fort Benning. And it was called the 11th Air Assault. And then when they felt the doctrine was solid, then they went and took the colors from the 1st Cavalry Division that were in Korea at that time and put them at Fort Benning. They took the 2nd Infantry Division colors, which I was a member of the 2nd Infantry Division, mm-hmm. and put them in Korea. So basically, they didn't swap a lot of people. They just switched the colors and the names of the units. The people who were in the provisional 11th Air Assault Division then became the 1st Air Cav. And they were the 1st Air Mobile Division in the world.
Wow.
They were then assigned to Vietnam. In the meantime, I went up to personnel, 2nd Infantry Division. I said I wanted to go to airborne school. because that's where the paratroopers were. The training school was at Fort Benning.
Yeah.
And the personnel manager up there, he says, no, you don't really want to do that. You want to be a helicopter pilot. Well, I knew nothing about airplanes. I mean, other than I never really had flown them. And I said, all right, I'll give it a shot.
Yeah.
Okay. So, unbeknownst to me, later on, I received orders to go to flight school. I took a written test and physicals and that type of stuff and passed all of them. And then they sent me off to flight school. The initial flight school at that time was in a place called Mineral Wells, Texas, down on the Brazos River. Out in the middle of nowhere, had the biggest hotel in the world and the smallest city. It was so pretty much abandoned then, but we could go out there and fly our helicopters, and we weren't endangering a lot of people.
Yeah.
And it was sort of a new thing, and I was one of the last of the small classes to go through. And we started out flying a very complex helicopter at that time. It was complex to fly. It was not a complex machine because it was known as the H-23 Hiller. And what it did is it had a lag in the flight controls. And these flight controls made it very difficult to fly because if you told it to go forward, it would not do anything. It'd just sit there for a while and look at you like you were stupid. And so I remember the first day our instructor came out, he took a few of us guys. He was a civilian. Mm-hmm. And they put us out under a tree out in this big field. And the guy said, I'll be out with the helicopter in a little while. I want to introduce you to it. This is the primary helicopter, the one we were learning on initially. And so he went ahead and took it, and there's a picture of it in that book over there if you want to see what it looks like. This H-23, it's sort of a bubble helicopter, and it'd carry about three people.
Yeah.
Okay. So it was very different. When he came out, and I remember him flying out there, he hovered out from the heliport. And he sort of sat there, and he had a cigarette in his mouth. In those days, you know, they were sort of lax. And so I don't know if he did it as a point of making a point or not. But as I remember, he took his cigarette out of his mouth, and he threw it on the ground. And he was hovering about 3 feet off the ground.
Yeah.
And right by under his skids there, so wasn't a lot of rotor wash right there. And he took the skids of the helicopter, the skids being, they didn't have wheels. I had skids like that helicopter there. They landed on skids. And he took his helicopter and he crushed a cigarette out with it.
What?
And he took it and rubbed it in the ground and put it out.
To show you what you could do with
it. Well, that was his point, obviously. And so he set it on the ground, turned it off, and so we learned how to fly this thing. It was very unusual. In fact, the first thing, it was so hard on one's physique and your concentration. That what he did is he went ahead and the first day they said, okay, we're going to teach you the rudder pedals. And he says, just try to keep it straight. And so we'd try to keep it straight. And we did that. And by that time, you were exhausted. So you go to the next guy. There were about five of us. And do it with the next guy. And we did this for a couple of days. And then the next day, he introduced us to the next control. Meantime, we were doing ground school. But they were next control, and that was a cyclic. That's the thing in the middle. You control lateral movement, forward and aft movement. And he says, now just try to move it a little bit to the left and a little bit to the right and forward and back. Well, the problem with this was is you put in a little forward motion. I remember that day. Put a little forward, nothing happened.
It just stayed in the same place.
Yeah, sort of sat right there. Because of the way the rotor system was built, it had a lag in it. Input lag, as we call it. It wasn't direct. And so you put in this little bit of movement to move it forward, as you'll learn how sensitive it was. And it didn't go anywhere. Meantime, the instructor pilot's sitting there holding the pedals, and he was sort of following to make sure he didn't do anything dumb. And so I put in a little bit more, and pretty soon the thing started moving forward. And it just kept moving forward, and it started getting faster and faster and faster in this big field. And so I pulled back on it, stop, you know, pulled back on the stick, like, whoa, horse. Well, I pulled it back, and the helicopter didn't stop. And it kept going. And I said, well, I got 40 acres here. Maybe I'll get a stop before I run out of 40 acres. And so I pulled back on the stick some more, and it began to slow down. But then it began to back up.
Oh, then you were going the opposite way.
I was going the opposite way back. We couldn't see where I was going. Didn't have rear view cameras in. And so I started going screaming backwards, and as I pushed in more, by this time I figured, well, I got to lead this thing a little bit. Anyway, I put, make a long story short, got it under control. And then we moved on to this, what we call the collective. And in those days, the collective was, you want me to be faster?
This is going to take hours.
Oh, okay. You want me to stop?
Keep going. Let them control it, but they're going to have to cut a lot of this, Charles.
No, we won't cut this. This is good.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we finally learned how that worked.
Yeah.
Okay, so, but I was very frustrated. I mean, it was like I came home in that evening, and I told my wife, I said, you know what? I will never learn how to do this. I'm just going to wash out of this program. I mean, it's just impossible to control this thing.
It would have been a totally new concept.
Well, yeah, and it had a built-in lag to it. And you know, I didn't know any different. So, you know, finally, and I was very frustrated for about a week or two or a week or so. And go back in every day and you do this. And it was very fatiguing to do this because it was just, I just fatigued. It's like you learn something new. It's just fatiguing. Yeah. And then you went to flight, you know, you did other things, like you went to ground school and stuff like that. So
you had more stuff on top of
charter. On top of that, you were learning a lot of technical stuff also, time, how navigation and et cetera. So it was just such a new concept. We had guys that were already pilots, were fixed wing pilots. And what they did is, we had a couple of them in our class wash out because they could never learn to control it.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't wash out, so they washed out of the class. And so finally one day, something happened. I just sort of, something clicked in my brain. And I was in the helicopter, and by this time I sort of learned all the controls. And we were beginning to fly a little bit on our own without a pilot, an instructor pilot with us. Mm-hmm. You know, we were soloed by this time. We had finally gotten into, I mean, before I soloed, really, it clicked. And I had to feel it. It was an aircraft that you truly had to feel, by what they used to say, the old pilots used to say, you had to fly it with the seat of your pants. You had to feel the aircraft move. You had to feel it wanting to shift with the wind.
Yeah.
Or the heat. Or the power. Because when you pulled in power, you had to roll in throttle. Because as the blades cut into the air, the engine wanted to lug down. So you had to roll it, like had a motorcycle grip on the throttle, you had to roll it into the left. And you had to keep your needles joined, the rotor needles and the engine needles, because you don't want to split them, because that means you want to keep them joined. So you're trying to monitor your instruments, keep the needles joined and that type of thing, and the aircraft. So finally one day it just sort of clicked. I felt it. I could feel the aircraft. I could anticipate what it was doing before it did it. So you're constantly flying. Most people fly like this, but this particular aircraft, you had to fly like this, but just cyclic. You had to stay ahead of it all the time.
Yeah.
And so you'd be flying along constantly doing this stuff because you were feeling it. That was it. Made it. So after that, we went to what we called advanced helicopter school. And then we went to turbine engines, or jets.
Yeah.
And we went down, and at that time, the Huey, the ubiquitous Huey aircraft, like you saw in the model here, was new then, and it was an A model, and they had A models, and they had great big fuel tanks sitting behind us. It was a smaller Huey, as they call them, and had the fuel tanks, and the fuel tanks were right behind us, very unsafe.
Yeah.
If you crashed, I mean, it would be all over, the fuel would just go all over you. But anyhow, that's what we had. And so we learned, how to fly on instruments and hoods and that type of stuff, and turbine aircraft. And then we started learning tactics. We went into air assaults, went into the woods, landed troops and that type of thing. We went into tactical maneuvers and night flying and cross-country flying and all that type of stuff. And then after I got out of that, everybody was getting orders. And this was at this flight school was at Fort Rucker, Alabama.
Yeah, so you came back.
So we moved from Mineral Wells, Texas to Fort Rucker, Alabama. Then what happened is after everyone was getting orders, because this time we were heavily involved in Vietnam. And this was in the buildup in 66, 50, 65 and 66. Well, the 1st Cavalry Division had deployed there. And they were working on the air assault. In fact, my class, many of my class members at that time immediately had orders to the 1st Cav.
Wow.
And everyone had orders going to, and everyone was basically going to the 1st Cavalry Division of the new pilots. Well, I didn't get any orders. And I said, well, I wonder why I didn't get any orders. I mean, what did I do? I mean, I graduated, I got my wings and all that. So I got my orders. Well, it turns out they didn't know. And finally, my orders came down. I was the only guy. I was selected to go to Fort Eustis, Virginia, to what is called the Aircraft Maintenance Officer's course, because my test, I had an aptitude for aircraft maintenance. So I went there, and I also went through a school of how to be a test pilot.
Yeah.
So I wound up being certified as a helicopter test pilot, for maintenance test pilot flying. And so after that, so I was there for about 16 weeks going through that course and getting certified. And all my friends had already gone to Vietnam. A number of those guys were already been wounded or killed by the time I got over there. But they had, but I was assigned to, my unit was assigned to a unit called the Vagabonds, which was this unit right back here. And I'm trying to remember which one it was. You may have to cut this out. Okay, I'll have to look it up, okay? The Vagabonds, and that was the 10th Aviation Battalion. And there's a plaque on the wall for the 10th Aviation. Soldiers of the Sky, I believe, up there on the plaque. Okay? And then, so there I was assigned to the 48th Assault Helicopter Company as a new pilot. And my job, and so when I first arrived in country, they flew me up to me, they took me and ferried me to a place up on the coast called Tui Wa South. And Tui Wa South was just a piece of beach, is all it was. And as I flew in with the aircraft, they were ferrying me in, the helicopter. I wasn't flying, I was being flown in. We flew over where they were fighting on the ground, and the air gunships were going in and strafing, and buildings were burning, and the guys calmly flew around, landed at a refueling point, refueled, picked up, went over to where our unit, the 48 Assault Helicopter, was on the beach. And they're known as Blue Stars. By the way, that there's a helicopter like that we had there in Soddy Daisy on a pole that says 48 Assault Helicopter Company. And I was with that unit.
Wow.
And so I didn't know what to do, and it was dark, and it was supper. Well, they'd already eaten supper, and so someone met me, and the place was sort of deserted. This was the 48th Assault Helicopter Company, or 48th Aviation Company, but it's an assault helicopter. And they were out on missions, flying an assault somewhere. And that's probably what I flew over as we came in, where the fighting was going on, and not too far away. So they put me in a tent. So I was in a tent with three other guys, but they were out on a mission. And during the night, it was after dark, no one showed up. I didn't get any dinner or nothing because it was after supper and the mess hall shut down. So I just went to bed, unpacked my duffel bag, and laid on a canvas cot. And a little after dark, all of a sudden I was shooting and machine guns going off and stuff going off, flares. And so I roll out of the cot onto the ground, crawl out through the tent flap and into a foxhole. I'm figuring we're under attack here. Grab my trusty .45 and ready to defend myself, maybe. But it was inside the perimeter. And all the shooting goes on for a while, and then it stops. And I said, well, didn't see anybody, nothing going on. So I got up, went back in the tent, got in the bed, back in the cot. And a little while later, it all started up again. So I go back out again and crawl into the hole. And this goes on for a while, and guess what? It stops. So I get up, go back into the tent. It started third time. This time I didn't get out of bed. I just stayed there. I said, this is pointless. And so a little bit later, I could hear the helicopters coming back, this gaggle of helicopters coming in. They were landing. And they came in, landed. Pretty soon my roommate showed up, and they were tired because they'd been out doing assaults all day, or not day, or doing stuff. And wait a minute. So that was my first experience there. And so I was assigned there as the newbie guy. It's the most undesirable job. And that was to be a pilot for the brigade commander for the 101st Airborne Division commanding general.
So you were his pilot?
I was one of his pilots.
Yeah.
Okay, I was one of the pilots. And I was assigned to that. And so we'd have to get up real early in the morning and go to his helipad because he was in another part of Tooheewaw, which is a narrow mountain, and fair distance away, about 5 minutes or so by helicopter. And so we'd get up there and I'm going to be before breakfast, before light, go out, pre-flight the aircraft, get in it, I and the crew, and we'd take off and we'd go out and we'd go over to his helipad. They had a hot spot. And we'd sit there, and they'd always flew, when we flew these missions, we always flew with gunship cover. It was armed attack helicopters with machine guns and rockets and that type of stuff. Heavily armed. Of course, we were armed too. We had two door gunners, but we weren't as heavily armed. And we always flew with an escort. Either one or two attack helicopters would fly as escort for the general. Mm-hmm. And what he would do at that time, this was during the buildup in Vietnam of forces, and we were beginning to attack the Vietnamese or the enemy forces. And so I would fly him, and this guy was a very unusual, very, very interesting guy. So we'd sit on the helipad, and so he'd come out after he had his breakfast and morning briefing and get in the helicopter, and we'd take off and go where he wanted. Most of the time, we'd go out and visit, like, Ford area, Green Beret Special Forces camps, so we're out in the middle of nowhere, mm-hmm. or fire bases out in the middle of nowhere, and he would go visit them.
Yeah.
And so we'd go out to these coordinates where he wanted to go, and we'd land, and he'd go in and do his thing, and
we'd
sit.
Wait at the helicopter?
We waited at the helicopter until he showed up, and he'd come back, and that's why nobody wanted to do this. You're sort of like a bus driver. But anyhow, but this fellow, he wanted to go, so we went to all these different places. So I remember one incident where he wanted to, we were flying along, and that day the gunships didn't have the range endurance that we did in the D model Huey. And they were flying B models or Hueys that were armed, and they were heavy and slow and not as fast. But they, and so they would usually call and tell us when they were down to what they called, we had to go, they had to refuel. They were down to 20-minute fuel warning light or enough fuel to get back to the refueling pad. And we were supposed to return then at that time. But I remember one time this general did wasn't through. And so he said, well, I'll tell you what you do. You tell the gunships to go on. And so the gunship commander leader said, well, you know, I'm not supposed to leave you without gunship cover. And he said, no, he says, tell them to go on, come to go on. Well, he's the general, so we sent them on. They had to go back and refuel. And so we're flying out in the middle of nowhere, just wherever he wanted to go. And finally, one time he said, tell you what, I need you guys to recon that area over there, us, all by our lonesomes. And he says, recon by fire.
Wow.
That means that he wanted our door gunners to open up on them, mm-hmm. that area. Well, that's sort of risky because we have no cover if we receive return fire, and we could receive a lot of return fire. So anyhow, we got away with it, and we returned with him safely. He had another incident with the same general who wanted us to land. One day we were flying around with him, and he wanted us to land. We saw rice paddies on each side and a road going down the middle, a dirt road. And there was this line of trucks and armored personnel carriers and stuff. And out front, these guys with minesweepers sweeping for mines. And he says, I want to go down there. I said, you want to go down there? Yeah, you want to go down there. Land down there. Well, there was nowhere to land except on the road where these guys in armored vehicles were. And these had these mine guys were sweeping mines out front, quite a distance in front of the vehicles because they were looking for mines.
Yeah.
He says, just land between the vehicles and the guys sweeping the road. Well, that didn't make us real happy to do that because the blades make pressure. Now, I don't know how sensitive the mines were or what they were finding or if finding anything. So we went down there and landed. And then we landed as far back as we could from these guys sweeping the road. And he says, I want you to move up. You want us to move up? Yeah, get close to these. I don't want to walk so far is what he was indicating. So we sort of scooted up a little bit. And he goes, well, okay, that's fine. So he gets out and he goes up and talks to these guys. And we're going, good night. Don't know what's going on. So again, we got away with that one. He came back and we flew back to it. Fortunately, or unfortunately after that, we had a guy in a sister unit next to us who was killed. Oh, we had a number of people killed, but this particular guy was an aircraft maintenance officer, and he was in the 129th Assault Helicopter Company, and he was with the 394th TC detachment. And he was apparently trying to what they call sling load some rotor blades. What we mean by that, you take the helicopter and you attach something underneath it, and he's trying to pick them up, apparently. And he picked them up, but the aerodynamics caused the blades to flip up and chop off his rotor system or something, and it caused him to crash and kill him and the crew, or at least kill him. So they had no maintenance guy, and so I got reassigned to them because I was a school-trained maintenance officer. And so I got assigned to them. And by the way, while I was with 48th, I did fly some combat assaults with them, but usually in max efforts. So I got to the 129th, and when I got to the 129th, which was called, they had the Georgia Bulldog on their tail, and it was called a Bite and Strike was their call sign. And so the strike was the Cobras, and they were like snakes, and that was their symbol. And they were their gunships, and then the Bite was the troop carriers. It went in. So I went with them, and I worked as a man at Tui while there on the beach. And finally, as they wanted us to move into a battle that was going on, and they wanted to move the unit into a combat area known up at a place called Kontum, up near the Laotian and Thailand border. And they were getting incursions or troop movements up in that area in the highlands, as it was called. Mm-hmm. And so the units all in that area just sort of picked up and left me on the beach by myself with my crew. By that time, I had a crew, and I had a bunch of aircraft that we were working on that were down. We were doing maintenance on them, but they couldn't fly. So my crew was either replacing engines or I being the test pilot for me. I was running the unit, and I had to fly the aircraft and test fly them and release them or whatever. Well, over there, when they left so fast, they left a big ammunition dump in the ground, in the sand, because they moved out so fast. And so I had to set out security and perimeters at night with my troops, because I had no perimeter security. And and I didn't have a whole lot of troops either to spare. These are mechanics and that type of stuff. And so we worked that out, and we had to guard this ammo dump. Well, what we'd had is we had people trying to infiltrate into this area and steal the weapon, the ammunition out.
That was left.
Yeah, and it usually is somebody like Mama San, you know, some Vietnamese older lady with little kids and something. They'd go in there and they would steal the ammo, or try to. And we had guards, and I'd get the guards to try to run them out. Well, one of my guards one day while I was there, and I kept trying to tell them I need security in here after this, and they were. But anyhow, so I didn't get it. And so one of my guards one time kept telling him to leave. You know, they got to the point where Americans were a threat to them. Soldier, they just ignored them. They go in there. And so he fired a round, so I understand, into the ground next to them to scare them off. Well, the round, because it was sandy, we determined, because it was sand, the bullet ricocheted and hit the woman. And so they came and got me, and I went and said, well, we got to get her to medical aid. And so we got her into medical aid. And so what they really really wanted to press charges against the soldier for shooting a civilian. And I said, wait a minute, he was doing his job. They weren't sure that they were warned, and they shouldn't. So anyhow, but it took a while to get him from being charged for court-martialed for that. And but it was fortunately the cooler senior heads prevailed. And they didn't court-martial him for that, because it was an accident. It wasn't intentional. And the woman was all right. She's fraud. She wasn't that badly hurt. And so they finally realized they needed to move this stuff. So they came in and got it and moved it out and removed it. And so then I was told I had to move from there. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, they need me to go to an airhead in what they call Tui Hoa, proper, which did have a proper airfield. It was just an old French airfield up there, small. But it was paved, one runway, no control at that time, I don't believe. And so, I said, well, how am I supposed to get from Tui Hoa South up there? Because I don't have any security, And I'm going to be moving a convoy because my unit, when I time I loaded up, took a number of C-123 aircraft to move it because we were air mobile.
Yeah.
And I had a helicopter I could get around in, but I needed to get this stuff moved. After so, when we got all the helicopters out that needed repair and all that stuff, so I said, okay. So I went down the beach, and as I remember, there was a unit down the beach, and it was an element of, I do believe, the 4th Infantry Division. It was on a beach. I think it was the 4th Infantry. And I went to their command tent. I said, look, I need some help to move my troops and my convoy up across at night to an airhead, to get to an airhead so that I can meet the aircraft at such and such a time and be picked up and move them. And I said, I need security. And I figured, I don't know if I'm going to get any security or not. And the guy said, okay, we'll give you some security. So they sure did. They gave me armed vehicles to go with us and escort us all the way. And we had no problem. We got the airhead. And so we moved that. So we moved our troops from there to a place called Khantoum. My troops flew out in the C-123s. And Khantoum was a very picturesque city up in the mountains. But I didn't know that at the time. And so I had a helicopter left, so I was flying up there. And when I, so I took one of these aircraft, and I was flying up there, and at night, that evening, and my instruments all went, or my lighting and my instruments, and so my instruments started failing on my aircraft. So I'm sitting there flying, with flashlight, and we made it. I go to Khantoum at night, and I'd never been there before, didn't know what it was like. So I got there, and it was pitch black. And so I land, and I went what we call IFR in the dust. In other words, I was so, when I landed, I kicked up so much dust in my rotor blades that I couldn't see anything.
Wow.
So we landed, luckily got it on the ground, and my crew met me, or that was with me, or that what I'd sent on ahead, and they had said, well, we got your tent up, and you can go to bed. It was late at night, and I was tired, and so I went in and went to bed, and I laid down and went sound asleep. The next thing I know, there's this crashing, banging going on. It was just awful. Big camp boom was going off. And I crawl out of my tent flap like that side, and while I was asleep, a battery of 105 howitzers came up and set up. It was about 50 feet from me, and were firing on the enemy.
Wow.
I didn't even hear them come in. Woke me up very well.
Yeah.
So we sat there, and I flew some combat operations there with them. Mm-hmm. When they got desperate, they'd ask me to fly missions with them. I also had an engine failure while I was there. I was test flying an aircraft for an engine replacement or repair. And I was flying when we were doing, and I had a crewman in the back who was, usually you fly just by yourself when you do that test flight because you fly with minimum crew because if you crash, you don't want to kill anybody you don't need. So I was there, and I was flying along, and he says, hey, sir, and I said, what? He says, after I was doing the checks and pulling power and stuff, various checks that you had to do, he says, I think you better find a place to put this stand. The engine's coming apart. I said, okay. So on the way down, I put it basically in auto-rotation. I didn't auto-rotate it, but I was under power, but I basically was auto-rotating down. I was falling very rapidly. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay. I started calling on my radios. I said, hey, I'm going down out here. I'm near this village, this sort of mountain yard village, and I need support. I need on the ground because this is an enemy country. We're out here, they're fighting the enemy out here in this area, and I don't know what's down there. And so they rogered that, and so I landed the ground right at this mountain yard village, and the next thing I know, I was surrounded by gunships. to cover me.
Yeah.
So they were very responsive. And so we got the aircraft repaired and refunded. That was one of the incidents there. I had another incident there where there was a French doctor, as I understand, and I received a call. I was out flying one day, and I received a call. It says that we have this French doctor at this such and such coordinates at this hospital area, and we would like you to pick her up and retake her and some of her people and get them out of the area. Is they're in an area where they need to leave.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, okay, well, give me the coordinates. So we got it. And I when I got there, it was sort of, as I remember, a rectangular building with a courtyard in the middle. And I went, anywhere else to land, Billy. So I landed in the courtyard. sort of went down between this square courtyard and landed in the middle. And I was test flying. It was an aircraft. I had a crew on this one. I can't remember why, but I had a crew on it. And with gunners and that type of stuff. So I wasn't probably test flying. I was probably doing something else. So the people run out. I don't really know them. I'm running. My engine is running. My rotor blades are turning. And so the crew chief hops out, helps them on board, and various this lady gets on, and we take off. And as I pull up out of the courtyard, I pull up because of the high altitude.
Yeah.
And the weight was in the aircraft. I started losing rotor power, lift, and the started bleeding off. But I'd gotten high enough that I could see over the top of the building in front of me, the roof, and there was a river on the other side. And so I just nosed it over and dove down into the river. And it was far enough down that I regained my rotor speed by putting my power down and climbed up on out with those people on.
Yeah.
That was kind of an interesting experience in the sense that she. Apparently was a fairly famous French doctor and had been written up. I don't know exactly who she was, but we evacuated her out of there. There were several other instances in that area. After there, we went to... Am I taking too long? Oh, yeah. After there, driving you crazy?
No, I'm enjoying every moment of it. This is good. And take your time. These stories are great.
So we went to, I can't remember all the different places. We did a number of combat missions, and I flew with some of the combat assaults.
Yeah.
And I remember one day I went into a place up there, and I'm trying to remember the name of the town. I think it was Pleiku, perhaps. Anyhow, I was flying in, and it's usually a fairly busy airstrip. And as I was flying in, it was awful quiet. I wondered what was going on in there. Why was it so quiet? So I flew in, called, didn't hear anything, didn't get a reply. Didn't see any helicopters around, no fixed wing aircraft.
Well, yeah.
So I pulled in and I get on the ground and I could see where the mortar rounds had hit. And that's where they were all undercover. Fortunately, I got out of that helicopter and it was okay. The attack was basically over when I landed, so I got lucky there.
Mm-hmm.
Then another combat assault, I do believe, with them, or maybe it was, I can't remember if it was them or the 148th. I think it was with 129th, because when they got desperate for pilots, they'd pull in the maintenance guy to do it. They didn't like doing that because they didn't want to particularly lose their maintenance pilot. I went ahead and, as I remember, I was on one combat mission, and you go in and you're in this gaggle of aircraft, which is quite interesting, and you're going in and the troops are nervous. You know, they don't know where they're going. They're landing. They're going into a strange area they've never seen. Of course, I hadn't seen it either, but I'm just going to go in and let them out. And get gone. And this is a normal operation. So we'd go in and shoot approach. And there was probably 15 or 20 helicopters with us or more. And the first flight in. And then we had gunships on each side, helicopter gunships. And they were going in and they were firing. And artillery was going in front of us. And you could see the artillery hit. And they were suppressing the perimeter of the area we were going in with fire they were doing. And so I go in there and I come in, and just as I come in with my helicopter, a round goes off right underneath me and sort of shoots us, sort of got my tail boom a little bit. And that was shrapnel. But I got them on, and you're only on the ground for about 3 seconds.
Wow.
And sometimes you don't even touch down. You come in, I come over these, land down, and within 3 or 4 seconds, those troops start getting out of that aircraft as soon as they get close to the ground. They start jumping out. And they don't want to be around it because you're a prime target. And they want to get out and disperse and get in the cover.
About how many troops would you generally
take? We would take about a squad. You take about a squad of troops per helicopter, maybe a little less depending on the capability of the aircraft and what they were carrying. So that'd be about 12 men.
Hmm.
Uh-huh. Plus your crew of four. You'd have a crew of four.
Yeah.
And we did that a number of different times in different places. We worked then with... I think I wound up with them going back and working with the Rock Tiger Division and the White Horse Division for Korea also at one time. Being the vagabonds, they moved us around all over the place for operations. And so we might go into a place and be there for 2 days, and then we'd pull out, or we'd just go in and land the troops and pull out. But in some operations, we'd go in and land and be there maybe 2, 3, 4 days and then pull out and go somewhere else, totally different in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the concept of air mobile operations at that time. The concept was to go where the enemy was, to block them or to attack them very quickly and with decisive force, because that was the new concept of air mobile. And so I was with them, and I stayed. When I first arrived in Vietnam in 66, and when I left in 67 after my first tour, in Tui Hoa South, it was just a sand beach. Remember I told you
yeah.
that, and that little old tree? Well, when I left, the Air Force had a huge runways in there, concreted with jets
wow.
and permanent buildings.
I built it in.
Built it in. That's how. And it, when we were first there, you always went out with your sidearm. You always wore a weapon or carried a rifle or a weapon, a sidearm, always. And but when I left, they prohibited us from carrying it in that same area because it was so pacified.
Wow.
Because we were more in danger of shooting yourself
yeah.
than you were then, or them shooting at you. So that was, so a lot of people say, well, we weren't winning. Well, I'm going to tell you, certain areas, it was, you know, it was no contest. I mean, it was just no contest. Now, so after I left Vietnam that time, I came back to the U.S., and I think I went to, I went down to Fort, McClellan, Alabama. No, it was Fort Stewart, Georgia, I think it was. Well, I went to advanced course up at Fort Eustis, Virginia, schooling.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went to Fort, and I was given a command of a company down in Fort Stewart, Georgia. And because my specialty was aviation, and my alternate specialty was transportation, because in those days, most pilots were all transportation corps.
Yeah.
They didn't have an aviation branch. And transportation corps colors are those colors on that hat over there. Okay, is that one with the red band on it?
Mm-hmm.
That's brick red and gold band, and that's the colors of the transportation corps. The colors of the, and then later on in my career, they formed a new branch in the Army. It was called the aviation branch, and us pilots were then were put into the aviation branch. And their colors are what's on that up there on the wall, the blue and the international orange. And so my colors changed at that time.
Yeah.
Okay, for that branch of the service for the Army. And my branch changed from Transportation Corps to Aviation Branch.
Mm-hmm.
So anyhow, so I was there at Transportation at Fort Stewart, Georgia, and I commanded a truck platoon at that time because I was a transportation officer. Is get ground experience because I wanted to get you diversified in your fields.
Yeah.
So I commanded it, and then from there, they just sent me to, I was up working a special forces operation up in the Carolinas with some special forces group on maneuvers. And I got orders at that time to go to back to flight school and go to Chinook Transition. Chinook Transitions are like you see on the wall here, the multi-rotor, multi-engine aircraft. So I went back to school to get certified in flying those. And I did that, and then they sent me to Vietnam.
Yeah.
And this was in 1969 and 70. In 1969 and 70, we were doing a pull down in Vietnam. That was the U.S. The United President Nixon was there.
Yeah.
We were all going to leave Vietnam. And the American people, a lot of protests were going on in the U.S. against war and all this type of thing. So you could see the difference when I went back. The morale was different.
And how it was when you left.
Last time when I went back, I went to the 1st Air Cav Division.
Mm-hmm.
I stayed with that 1st Air Cav Division and flew with them and did some operations with them until I left in 1970. And so I was there a year with them. From there, I think I went to, I may have gone to, I think I went to, maybe I went to Fort I went to Fort Stewart at one point in time, and at Fort Stewart, Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
And there I was had an aviation unit, as I, you know, Fort Stewart, I was in an aviation unit there, and flew aircraft and test flew aircraft and that type of thing with a maintenance unit.
Yeah.
And did that, and then I went to, then I was given orders to Germany. And I went to Germany, and of course we had a big force in Germany. And at that time I was in quarters, my wife and my two children, and they had, and I got orders all of a sudden, and they said, hey, they want you in Germany tomorrow. Well, you mean you want me there within the week is what it was, within the week. I said, what do I do with my family and quarters and stuff? What do I do with them? And they said, so I went to the commanding general, post commander, and he says, well, you can leave them in quarters and we'll see if they're okay and see what's going on. He says, but we tried to get your orders moved so your family could move with you. And he says, but they won't have it. They want you in Germany now because the corps commander, the 5th Corps, wants you there to be the Corps Aircraft Maintenance Officer for the 5th Corps. Now, a corps is usually 3 to 5 divisions.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, it's usually normally three to five divisions, okay? Division is somewhere 10 to 15,000 troops,
mm-hmm.
okay? Each division, 12 to 15,000, depending on the type of division, armored or infantry divisions and how they're organized. And we had 2 corps in Europe at the time. We had 7th Corps and 5th Corps. And you know, because the Russian threat was very large back then,
yeah.
them attacking through a place called the Fulda Gap was a primary avenue of attack. And sitting astride the Fulda Gap was elements of the 5th Corps, and part of one of its brigades is the Black Horse Brigade was sitting up right across the Fulda Gap to act as a blocking force if the Russians tried to come through with armor, and they were very heavily armored. And so the U.S. was not as heavily armored. But anyhow, so he went someone over there real fast. So they had very heavy assets because the air concept, mobility concept was there. So I was there and I served on the 5th Corps staff for a while. And then I eventually formed a unit, helped design a unit called the Aviation Intermediate Maintenance Battalion, which was designed in 5th Corps and approved by the Army. And it's today one of the type base units of the Army maintenance, aviation maintenance system.
Yeah.
And did that there, and I did a number of exercises. After Germany, I went to, after so many, about 3 years,
mm-hmm.
Was assigned to Los Angeles to a readiness group, LA. And our job then was to be advisors to Army Reserve units and anybody else they wanted us to be advisors to as instructors and type of thing. So I did that for a while. And then my next sign, I do believe, was St. Louis to the Aviation Systems Command. And Aviation Systems Command, I worked in the Material Division in readiness, for combat readiness.
Yeah.
And we did all kinds of things, managed all kinds of material, or aircraft, even down to dogs. We managed them. Okay. So we did that, and from there I was assigned to the Pentagon and the logistics. And my job in the Pentagon was to work in the Plans and Programming Division, and my primary job was to work on what they call this is a POM, the Program Objective Memorandum for the Army. And what this basically is the budgeting system within the military, how we budget, how we buy things in the military. How do we and monitor those contracts? And we had a program 15 years out buying things because many contracts take very long lead-in times. It takes to develop an aircraft take 10, 15 years. And so you have to budget all those years. And then we had to work basically on this budgeting process and planning processes to get ready for what was the State of the Union address. So we had to have everything ready to go to the people who briefed the president before, so he had the information to go to the before Congress and give the State of the Union address. So that was
what year was this?
That was in 1980s, early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was there for several years and did that, got involved in some interesting things there, but you can't really talk about them. So I won't. there were several things I've went over I can't talk about in back there. But even in Germany, there were things you couldn't talk about. Mm-hmm. It still affects us to this day. But anyhow, it was a very, and so after there, after my, I put in 20 some years
in the military,
21, yeah, no, at the end of my tour in the Pentagon, I retired and came settled here in Tennessee.